वेलकम, नमस्कार। आई एम मीनाक्षी कुमार, फैकल्टी ऑफ फोटोग्रामेट्री एंड रिमोट सेंसिंग डिपार्टमेंट, रिमोट सेंसिंग एंड जियोइन्फॉर्मेटिक्स ग्रुप इन इंडियन इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ रिमोट सेंसिंग, विच इज़ अ प्रीमियर ट्रेनिंग इंस्टीट्यूट अंडर इंडियन स्पेस रिसर्च ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया। इन टूडेज सेशन वी विल सी द बेसिक कॉन्सेप्ट्स ऑफ डिजिटल इमेज प्रोसेसिंग, and this we'll be seeing in form of structure of a digital image, overview of digital image processing, and the first functionality of image processing, which is basically image reprocessing in form of radiometric and geometric error correction. To start with, all of us have heard of the famous Chinese adage, a picture is worth 1,000 words. Indeed, there is no doubt that if I support my textual information with a picture information, it conveys much more meaning, right? Like, for example, in this particular slide, if I go on describing the textual description of ice cream, the user will take a lot of time to actually understand what object I am describing. If I accompany it with picture, it gives much more meaningful information, and you can say more information is conveyed in short time. But what we are talking about is not simple graphical pictures or photographs. We, in our context, the picture is the picture captured by Earth Observation Satellite Sensor. That means basically a remotely sensed satellite image. So now we are using the term image. What is an image then? Image is simply a pictorial representation. A pictorial representation of an object, scene, or a phenomena. And there are two forms of images. Analog image and a digital image. Analog, the word analog itself means a continuously varying quantity. So analog images are captured by our photographic sensors on paper-based media or transparent media. And what is represented in analog image is continuously varying quantity, which is either intensity or a color, as we can see on the slide, right? So even though I have represented here a satellite image and a photograph and a portrait, all I am putting under the category of an analog image, because what we are representing here is either intensity or a color, which is basically a continuously varying quantity. But the satellite images, and in fact most of the images nowadays, are captured in digital mode. So what is basically a digital image? A digital image is produced by electro-optical sensors. A digital image is composed of tiny equal areas, which are called as picture elements and abbreviated as pixels or pels, and they are arranged in a matrix form, arranged in rows and column or rectangular array. And this is simply a structure, a grid structure of rows and columns. So with each pixel is associated a number, and this number can be called as either digital number, abbreviated as DN, or a brightness value, may be abbreviated as BV, or a gray level, GL, right? Which is basically a record of reflected, emitted, or backscattered energy, depending upon the type of remote sensing that we are dealing with. So let's say, for focusing the lecture, we say it is in optical remote sensing, it is reflected energy in discrete form, which is recorded. The concept will be an object which reflects more energy will be brighter in an analog image, and here it will have a higher digital number, and vice versa. That means an object reflecting less energy will be darker in an analog image, and here it will register in a smaller DN value. Here I am showing the structure of a hypothetical digital image, a very small image of 5 columns and 5 rows. The origin of this image is at top left corner. The rows are called as scan lines, and they correspond to the movement of the satellite. They are captured when the satellite is moving along. Columns correspond to the columns are known as pixels, and they correspond to the number of detectors on your linear CCD array if we are talking about a push broom sensor. Now we said that with each pixel, so this is a small area which basically is a pixel, and it represents a small area in the on the ground, which is all equivalent to the spatial resolution of the sensor. Now the range of DN values depend upon the radiometric resolution of the sensor. If the radiometry of the sensor is 8 bit, that means there will be 256 different gray levels, and the range of values will be between 0 to 255. And if it is 10 bit, the range of values will be between 0 to 1023, that is basically 1024 levels. Here I am depicting an 11 bit data also. In the 11 bit data, the values will be between 0 to 2047. The object which is reflecting all energy will be having the highest value, 2047. An object reflecting no energy at all will be the darkest, having a value of 0. Now, remotely sensed data is multispectral in nature. That means we capture the image of the same area in different wavelength intervals, called as band. So you can imagine that a multispectral remotely sensed data is a digital image of the same area stacked together. You can say for a large number of bands. And then if I want to refer to any pixel location, it will be referred first by its column position, then by its row position in a particular band. Right? So here the image which is being shown is the image from Indian Remote Sensing Satellite IRIS-1B linear imaging self-scanning LIST-2 sensor, which has a spatial resolution of 36.25 meter in four bands, as the wavelength ranges are mentioned here. And this is the visual representation of those images. In the background, the images are made up of digital numbers. So here I am trying to show digital numbers of the initial big part of the image. Now, having defined image and a digital image, we are ready to see what is digital image processing. Now, image, we have seen digital image, then digital image processing in simple words is manipulation of digital numbers contained in the remotely sensed data with the help of computer. But we do it for a purpose. We do it for removing any kind of error from the satellite image, for enhancing the image, and extracting useful information. So we have defined digital image processing as computer manipulation of digital values contained in an image for purpose of correction, enhancement, and information extraction. Now, since we have to do processing, we need a processing system. And most of the processing systems are based around a hardware and a software. In our case, the hardware is a simple personal computer which is sufficient to do image processing, because nowadays the capabilities of personal computers are manifold, and image processing can be done using personal computers and even laptops. And we require a dedicated image processing software and application software, which is necessary to analyze the digital values contained in the satellite data. The software, that dedicated software, image processing software, should at least have three basic functionalities. The minimum requirement is that it should allow us to remove all kind of errors from the satellite image in form of image. So that means image restoration should be possible. The second category is we should be able to enhance the image. And third category is that we use the decision-making capability and extract meaningful information out of the data in form of classification, that is making thematic maps out of our satellite, the imageries. So now we will see different functionalities. Before that, if you see in the market, there are large number of commercial image processing softwares which are available. To name a few, I have listed here some commercial softwares like Adas Imagine, Envy, Idrisi, ERMapper, Geomatica, Ecognition, which is basically an object-oriented software, MATLAB, Mathematics Laboratory, which has many other tools also in addition to image processing. So you will find number of commercial softwares as well as a large number of open source softwares. It was not possible to list all the open source softwares here. So this is just a few softwares which are listed here out of the large list. Like for example, ILWIS, which is Integrated Land and Water Information System, developed by ITC Netherlands, Optex, GRASS, OSIM, Multispec, QGIS, EIP tools, etc. I've also listed the sites from where you can download them. So now coming to each functionality of the image processing software, in today's session we will see the first functionality, that is removing any kind of error from the satellite image. This is termed as image pre-processing. Now why we need to do pre-processing is that our remote sensing systems, which are basically satellites and sensors, they are man-made systems, and they may not function perfectly all the time, right? And what they are recording is Earth's surface. In addition to recording the Earth's surface, there is atmosphere in between. We are trying to record land and water phenomena, which are basically complex. And they recording them by remote sensing devices, which itself has constraints like certain spatial resolution, spectral resolution, temporal and So it has various constraints like different resolutions. Error may creep in into the data acquisition process, and the data that has been collected may have degraded quality. Now the two most common type of errors that can come and that can be encountered in your remotely sensed data are the radiometric and geometric error. And correcting for both the errors is termed as pre-processing, because this operation must be done prior to any information extraction. Now what are radiometric errors and what are their causes? Radiometry, as we know, it is related to the digital value. So when the value of a pixel is distorted, it is the radiometric error. And the value is distorted due to detector imbalance, the CCD array or the Wistrom sensor, the mirror and the scanner combination. So when the detector goes faulty, we get radiometric error. And radiometric corrections are called as cosmetic corrections, because they are done to improve the visual appearance of the image. To name a few radiometric errors, they are periodic line or column dropouts, line or column stripings, random bad pixels, which is basically short noise. It can be partial line and column dropouts and atmospheric errors. Now line dropout means when a particular detector fails completely to record information, it results in a complete line or a column having a value of zero. So when a complete line column has a value of zero, there is a banding pattern with black lines, right? Now it can be periodic, that means a certain like 16th line, every systematic line can be dropped, or we can have a random line which can be having a value of zero. The correction mechanism would first require identification of the bad line. So the correction mechanism, we have to identify a bad line. We will run a thresholding algorithm. In thresholding algorithm, the simplest algorithm would be finding the average of each line. And wherever the average is near zero, it can be identified as a bad line, right? Because it's a complete dropout, value will be zero. So its average will also be zero or near zero if there is there are small values in the line. So once it is detected, then the correction mechanisms are very easy. We replace the bad pixel by its neighbors. That means we can replace the dropped line by the preceding line or by the succeeding line, or we can average of the two. That means the average of the preceding and the succeeding line. There is also a possibility that there is a line dropout or column dropout only in one of the band. So another band which has the data intact for that particular line, so this can, the line can be replaced from that highly correlated band. And line dropout will occur in whisk broom type of sensors, and column dropout will occur in push broom type sensors. The second type of error is also again related to line and column striping, which is basically banding effect. In this line striping or column striping, the detector does not fail to record, but its response shifts towards either higher side or lower side, causing a periodic banding pattern, either a horizontal pattern or a vertical pattern, as you can see on the slide. So basically this banding pattern, it interferes with our interpretation of objects, hence it has to be removed. Why it happens? Because once the sensor is on board the satellite, there are variations in its gain and offset conditions as the sensor deteriorates in time. So the correction mechanisms would again be identifying a standard detector whose response has not shifted over time, and we can use a linear sensor model to map the response of the faulty detector, which is taken as input, to a standard output, that is basically the reference detector, assuming that the mean and standard deviation of each detector should be the same. Then the third category of errors are atmospheric induced errors, right? So in remote sensing, you must have been told that the electromagnetic radiation, it travels through the atmosphere twice. That is, once from the source of illumination to the target, and again back from target to the sensor. So the number of errors that are introduced during this process are called as haze, and this must have been introduced earlier also. That is the shorter wavelengths are scattered. So it is the scattered light which reaches the sensor from the atmosphere. This particular one. The one where the light in the atmosphere is scattered and it reaches the sensor. So the value is coming from the ground also, that is target also. In addition, this value goes and adds itself to the sensor value, and it is an addictive effect. It reduces the contrast in the imagery. The second type of atmospheric error is a skylight, which is basically scattered light reaching the sensor after being reflected from the Earth's surface. There is one reflectance, which is reflected value, which is reaching the sensor. The reflected value from the neighboring sensor is also scattered, and it reaches the field of view of the sensor, which is skylight. It is a multiplicative effect and difficult to remove. Then the third category is due to the sun angle, that is different position of the sun, which and the path that the radiance takes to reach the Earth. So this is also changes the DN values, and it is also a multiplicative effect. Now here, this effect of haze is very clearly visible. You also must have observed that whenever you go to a hill station and try to capture the image from your camera, the if the sky is not clear, the image comes as hazy, blue, bluish appearance. Similar to what is observed here, because the shorter wavelengths are scattered. So this haze has to be removed for interpretation of objects. So here we see a haze removed of imagery, haze corrected imagery. How it is done, we will see in the next slide. So the most common method of haze correction is called as dark object subtraction or histogram minimum method. Now what here is assumed, that we have said that since the shorter wavelengths are scattered more, we are assuming that they are not affected by the haze. So in these infrared bands, we identify objects where we are expecting zero reflectance. That means objects which do not reflect any energy at all. So identify these objects in the shorter wavelength bands on the same pixel position, and whatever DN value are there, it is assumed that it is due to the haze. So we subtract this minimum value from all pixels of that band, and we say that, so that is why it is called as dark object subtraction. That is the minimum value of that particular pixel, which is not supposed to reflect any value at all, that is subtracted from all DN values. That is why it is called as dark object subtraction or histogram minimum method. How sun angle correction is done? We know that the position of sun relative to the earth changes depending upon the time of the day and the day of the year. That means, in other words, we can say the solar elevation angle is time and location dependent. In the northern hemisphere, the solar elevation angle is smaller in winter than in the summer. And if we calculate the solar zenith angle, that means the angle of the sun directly overhead, that means it is 90 degrees minus the sun elevation angle. And the irradiance from sun, irradiance is the energy that is coming from sun to the earth. It varies with seasonal changes in this solar elevation angle and the distance between the earth and sun. As you know, distance between earth and sun changes according to the Julian day formula. So why the sun angle correction is necessary? It is necessary whenever we are using different scenes and we want to make a mosaic of them, or when we want to do a temporal study, that is change detection. How the correction is done? Here you can see that. So image data, here we are showing two images acquired under different solar illumination angles, right? And they are normalized by calculating the pixel brightness values, assuming that sun was at zenith, that means exactly overhead. And the correction is applied by dividing each pixel of the slave image. One is considered as reference and the other one is considered as slave. So it is dividing each pixel of the image that is to be corrected by the sign of solar elevation angle for that particular time and location of the image. So here you can see that the two images are now having same radiometry and they are mosaic. If we mosaic in this condition, they are having different radiometry and objects are not clearly interpretable. Now with this we have seen the basic radiometric errors and their correction mechanisms. Now let us come to geometric errors and their correction. All of us understand the meaning of the word geometric, right? We are talking in terms of remote sensing data. If the location of a particular pixel is distorted or it doesn't conform to a north-south oriented map, we say that image has geometric error. So when the DN value is distorted of a particular pixel, we say there is a radiometric error, and when the location of that particular pixel is distorted, we call it geometric error. So the transformation of remotely sensed image, so that it has a particular scale and projection of a map, it is called as geometric correction. It is concerned with placing the reflected, that means in optical remote sensing, emitted in thermal remote sensing, or backscattered measurements in your microwave remote sensing in their proper planimetric location so that they can be associated with other geographic information systems. So here it includes removing all kind of geometric errors which may arise according to the sensor tree or the earth geometry or its variations, or simply conversion of data from one grid system to another grid system. That means from one projection system to another projection system. So in all these cases, the geometric error correction is done. Now we will see one of the effects. It is not possible to discuss all the sensor geometric errors and the earth geometry effects. We are seeing here first geometric effect due to the earth geometry. Now this is called as earth rotation effect. Now all of you know now that sun synchronous satellites are normally in this fixed orbit, right? They are collecting the data when the satellite is moving from north to the south, and it is capturing a swath of data right here, which is basically it is following a certain orbit path and its ground trace, right? So that data is being recorded as the satellite moves from north to south in the descending pass. Now once it has moving from one, capturing one line to near to the other, the earth below rotates on its axis, right? The earth below rotates on its axis from west to east, and we know it makes complete revolution every 24 hours. So what happens is the satellite is continuously capturing the data. So this, the data that we get is this dashed line, right? So it captures one line of data, then it captures next line of data, and it gives us this rectangular picture. But actually, due to the earth rotation geometry, as it is moving forward, the earth rotates underneath. So it actually it is looking west, right? So this data should have been like this, each line offsetted to the west, that is the solid line here. So this correction, though this is not an error, it is simply the earth geometry and the satellite geometry. So this error has to be corrected. So the correction procedure, a common correction procedure, is called as rectification. Right? So rectification can be defined as process of geometrically correcting an image so that we can overlay it over a map, so that it can be conformed to any other image or to the map. We can say, in other words, it's a process by which geometry of an image is made planimetric. Why we need to do this process is whenever I want to use my image as image map. Why do we use map? We use a map to make accurate area, distance and direction measurements, right? So whenever I want to use my image as an image map, I do a process called as rectification. Rectification is achieved by transforming data from one grid system into another grid system using geometric transformation. One grid system, which is basically an image in rows and columns or scan lines and pixels. Another grid system may be map in terms of latitude, longitude, or northing, easting in a certain map projection like UTM, etc. Right? So this grid transformation is obtained by geometric transformation, which is basically establishing mathematical relationship between address of pixel and corresponding coordinates of those pixels on any other image or on ground. So the procedure is basically a two-step procedure. So two basic operations must be performed for geometric transformation. right? So first is geometric transformation coefficient computation, and second is intensity interpolation. So in the first step, we identify the mathematical relationship or the geometrical relationship between the input pixel location, which is rows and columns, and its associated map coordinates of the same pixel, that means either in latitude longitudes or northing easting. So we identify a geometrical relationship, or in fact we build a geometrical relationship and calculate the transformation coefficients. This step involves selecting ground control points, abbreviated as GCPs, more commonly known as GCPs, and fitting simple or complex polynomial equations using least square technique. The second step is called as intensity interpolation. Excuse me, please. Intensity interpolation is a step after the geometric transformation coefficients are calculated. It is equivalent to finding an empty output grid or overlapping an empty output grid over our map or any other image, and then filling in the DN values in that empty grid. So this is called as intensity interpolation or filling in the DN values. Now we will see these two steps. So first we will see what is ground control point. Now it's a control point. So it's basically a location on, and it's a ground control point, that means it's basically a location on surface of the earth, right? Which can be very clearly identified on the imagery as well as located accurately on a map. So a ground control point will have two set of coordinates. One will be called as source coordinates and other will be reference coordinates. Source coordinates means my image which I'm transforming to another grid system. So image coordinates, which will be in terms of rows and columns, and my reference coordinates will be in latitudes, longitudes or northing eastings in a certain map projection system. Now the accuracy of my transformation depends upon how accurately I have identified my ground control points. So it is necessary that I take ground control points well spread on my entire image. Now depending upon the resolution of the satellite image, right, we can take pixels which are falling on the road intersections or airport runways, corners of buildings, etc. That means certain man-made features which are very clearly identified on high resolution data. But if your resolution medium to low, we can take larger features like larger urban areas or geological features. In taking such features, we have to be very careful that landmarks which may vary should not be used. Landmarks like lakes or any other water body where the water level may recede or may expand, should not, the corner of such things should not be taken as the ground control point. Similarly, if you are taking a tip of a forested patch, the forest may have been cleared or afforestation is done and the tip has changed. So such landmarks should not be taken as ground control point, because it is the accuracy of these ground control points which will determine my accuracy of rectification. And we require a minimum number of ground control points depending upon the polynomial equations that we are going to use. So we should use sufficiently large number than the minimum requirement for transforming our data set. What is that minimum requirement? We will see once we have seen what are the different type of polynomial equations that can be used. So polynomial equations are used to convert my source coordinates to my rectified map coordinates. Right? Now, depending upon the distortions in the data, the number of ground control points that I have, the location of the ground control points with respect to each other, the size of my study area, I can use either simple polynomial equations or complex polynomial equations. Now, complexity of a polynomial is basically, or the degree of the complexity of polynomial is the order of the polynomial. And order is simply the highest exponent used in the polynomial. Now, for example, here I am showing a first order polynomial because the power of x and power of y is 1. Right? If the power is 2, that is if it's a quadratic equation, it becomes a second order equation. So here I'm showing a linear transformation or a first order transformation, also called as affine transformation. The small x and y are used for the source coordinates, which is my basically input image, which I am registering or rectifying. And x, capital X and y are used as rectified coordinates or my map coordinates. Right? So this first order polynomial, which is basically the capital X or rectified output X, is equal to a0 plus a1x plus a2 small y, y is equal to b0 plus b1x plus b2y. This first order transformation can make a change in the location of pixels in x and y, change in scale, that means compressing the image or expanding it, that is k differential scaling, skewness means offsetting of the each line either to the left or right, that is east or west, and rotation. So these are basically four differences in geometry. These are four differences in geometry between my image and my map. And this first order equation is sufficient to make my four changes in geometry. So if I use this first order transformation for my particular image and my particular map, I have to calculate these constants called as a0, a1, a2, b0, b1, b2. That means if I calculate these six coefficients, and these six coefficients are called as geometric coefficients or geometric transformation parameters. So if I calculate these six coefficients, then for any pixel on the image, I can calculate its corresponding position on the map. And vice versa, I can also calculate back if any location on the rectified coordinate where it would lie on the image. So I need to calculate these six coefficients, right? So each, if I take one ground control point will give me two equations. As we can see, with one ground control point, I get two equations. So I have six unknowns. That means I require a minimum of only three ground control points for solving the equation, and I can relate my image to the map. But with these three ground control points, I will not be able to estimate if there's any error in any ground control point. Right? So instead of taking the minimum required three ground control points, we take one additional ground control point. Now once we have four ground control points, I will have eight equations. And once I have eight equations, my unknowns are only six. So that means I have more number of equations and less unknowns. Then that, for that purpose, a fitting technique called as least square fitting is used, and the coefficients A0, A1, A2, B0, B1, B2 are calculated. Still, before applying the rectification to entire data, that means calculating where each pixel would lie on the map, we have to test what is the accuracy that is achieved with these four ground control points. we have to check how much accuracy we can get with these four ground control points. Now, how to do that? Right? So, we have taken four ground control points to compute the six coefficients. Right? Now, we can do is, one by one, for each ground control point, I can put the ground control reference like coordinates in the equation and compute from where it came. That means which is the source input and input row and column corresponding to the ground position. So for each ground control point I will do that. Now once I have computed the source position, ideally I would expect if there is no error in my transformation that the computed value for a ground control point and the reference value, that the one which we had taken as reference, maybe with the help of from a map or from GPS, that there is no difference between the two. If there is no error, I repeat, if there is no error, the computed value for a ground control point and its measured value should be exactly equal, right? And you know, since we have used the least square fitting technique, these two will never match. There will be slight difference in the values, maybe in the second decimal position or third decimal position, but the error will not be exactly zero, right? So what we calculate this error. So this error is actually the distance between the computed position and the measured position, right? And this error is called as root mean square error, or a popularly called as RMS error, RMST also, right? So RMS error is basically distance between the input location of a ground control point and its computed position for the same ground control point, right? Like here with this image, it is more clearly visible that if this was my ground control point, it is computed position is here. So this distance my error. If this distance d is 0, my source and transformed value lie at the same position. So larger this distance, larger the error. Right? So, and we know how to calculate distance between two points. If the one value is x1, y1, x2, y2, then simple Euclidean distance formula you can apply to compute this distance. Right? Square root of x2 minus x1 square plus y2 minus y1 square, that will give you the distance error. Now how much error is acceptable? That is a question. Now amount of RMS error that can be tolerated is thought of as a window around a source coordinate inside which if a computed coordinate lies, it is considered correct. Like for example, if I say that my RMS error of 1 is acceptable to me, as example, okay, not that I'm saying that RMS 1 is acceptable. Example, if RMS error 1 is acceptable to me, this means that I make a circle with a radius of 1 pixel, and if my computed value lies anywhere inside this circle, it will be considered as correct. Now, how much RMS should be acceptable? It depends upon what is the purpose of my transformation. That means where I'm going to make end use of this data. If my purpose is very accurate, precise cadastral mapping, I have to have least amount of error. If I'm simply going to overlay and display an image, my amount of acceptable error may increase. It also depends upon what is the data that I have, right? And it also depends upon how accurate are my ground control points, right? Normally, an RMS error of less than 1 per ground control point is acceptable. Yeah? I remember I told you that we will do this error calculation for each ground control point and then we will find an average RMS error. So RMS error of less than 1 per ground control point is acceptable, and total or an average RMS error of less than 0.5 is acceptable. Like for example, In this picture, we see we have taken four ground control points where their row and column positions and corresponding latitude and longitude points. There is an RMS error of 0.03 in one pixel. In the first ground control point, RMS error of 0.58 in the second. Point number 3 has 0.53 RMS error and RMS error of 0.01 in the fourth ground control point. So if I take an average RMS error, it will be less than 0.5. Now what if any ground control point has an RMS error of more than 1? Then that point should be deleted and new ground control point should be MAN, and the error should be brought down from 1 to 1 per ground control point, and average will be should be less than 0.5 RMS. So it also tells, the softwares normally tell how much is the percentage of error ground control point. Now with this we have finished the first step where we have overlaid an empty grid over my map or my another rectified image. The second step is intensity interpolation or resampling, or basically I told you it's a step of filling in DN values. So the question is, once image is warped, that is overlaid over the reference map, how are the DN values assigned to the new grid? Right? Now if we look, because my old grid had DN values, new grid is empty. So if I look back from new grid to the old grid and try to find out where this particular pixel came from, the two grids do not match perfectly. They may be in a rotated position, scaled up or scaled down. Right? So two grids will rarely match exactly. That means pixel by pixel overlay is not possible. Right? So now what we have to do, we have to fill in the output grid, extracting the brightness values from the input image and putting them in its appropriate location in the output image. When we do this, the output of the transformation, that means the when I'm looking back a particular rectified coordinate where it came from, the result will be that input line and column numbers are real numbers and not integers. Whereas when I started with my original image, image has in the addresses of pixels in integer rows and integer columns. Right? So when I look back, because of the least square fitting technique, they result in real numbers and not integers. So once this happens, I have to adopt a method of assigning brightness value, which may be nearest neighbor or bilinear or cubic convolution. So one of the methods I can use to assign DN value. Now what are these values? What are these procedures? So basically nearest neighbor approach will use the closest pixel, input pixel, to the rectified output pixel. And that value will be taken and put in its appropriate location in the output georeference image. Like for example, if this was my original grid in dash and this is my rectified grid in which I have to fill in the DN value, and this light gray pixel, it gets its DN value from the closest pixel which is here. So if we look in terms of the addresses, indices, then I can say that if I simply round up the coefficient values that I obtain, I can use that pixel and replace the value. Like for example, in this, I am expecting this particular pixel is expecting a DN value from a pixel location at 2.4 and 2.7. So if I round up 2.4 and 2.7, that means I should take a DN value from column 2 and row 3. So this DN value 15 should be taken and placed in its location at this required location. This is called as nearest neighbor approach. So this nearest neighbor approach, in whichever quadrant the DN value lies, that particular nearest pixel will be taken and replaced in the output image. Now, what are the advantages and disadvantages of using this nearest neighbor approach? The nearest neighbor, this is a simple approach, nearest neighbor, because what we are doing is we are taking a DN value from the original image, right? So we are taking a value from the original image and placing it in the output image, right? So original data is retained. It is very simple method, easy to compute and fastest to use. But it has a disadvantage that it produces basically a stair-step defect, a blocky effect on the image, right? So the image is not smooth. Reason being that some of the data values are lost and some values are duplicated in the output image because we are looking back in the input pixel. The second approach for filling in the DN value is called as bilinear interpolation, which basically is an averaging approach where we take weighted average of the four nearest pixels. I emphasize it is not the simple average of four nearest pixels, but a weighted average. Weight being calculated from the distance from point in question, right? So weight is calculated by the distance squared from the point in question. So like in the previous example, in nearest neighbor approach, we found that 15 value will be used in the output image being the nearest neighbor, but here now the weighted average of four nearest pixels will be taken and replaced in the output image. Advantages and disadvantages. Now the disadvantage of nearest neighbor approach, which was basically a stair-step or a blocky appearance in the image, will be removed by this nearest neighbor approach. That means the output image that I get will be smoother than the nearest neighbor resampling approach. Disadvantage, I am not taking a DN value from the raw data, but I am computing a new value by calculating the average of the four nearest pixels. Right, so obviously it will take much more time than the nearest neighbor mix approach. The third resampling technique is the cubic convolution approach. So the cubic convolution approach is similar to my bilinear interpolation. The difference is bilinear interpolation takes a weighted average of four nearest pixels. Here it takes the weighted average of 16 pixels, right? And the output is similar to bilinear interpolation, but the averaging will be more, so smoothing will be more, right? So formula you can see is the same, only difference is that is the weighted average of four pixels. Here is the weighted average of 16 nearest pixels. Advantages and disadvantages will also be similar, exactly similar to bilinear interpolation. Stair-step defect of nearest neighbor approach will be removed. An image will be much more smoother. And disadvantage is same, that since we are averaging, it is not a raw data. We are using a computed value. And it will take much more time even than the nearest neighbor or even the bilinear interpolation. So if I compare, right, so the nearest neighbor approach will take the smallest time. Now how we do it on in the imagery, if this is my satellite image, I identify the ground control points. In the softwares, we will not be dealing with the mathematical notations. We can simply use the software to simply mark the ground control points, identify points which can be very clearly identified on the image, as well as topo sheet, or we can go to the ground with help of a GPS receiver and get the location. So we identify the minimum required points, that is four in our case of first order transformation, compute the equations, right, and do the resampling. So my input image will be retransformed. My input image will be rectified or aligned according to a north-south oriented map, and if you see the status bar, your each pixel will have row column position as well as a northing, easting or latitude longitude coins. Now we have seen only the first order transformation. The second order transformation, if I go back, I did not include in the slides because mathematics scares some people, right? For those of you who are interested, a second order transformation would be x is equal to a naught plus a1x plus a2y plus a3x square plus a4y square plus a5xy. So this will make it second order. Similar in y. So now minimum required ground control points will increase because my a0, a1, a2, a3, a4, a5 are there, and similarly b2. So number of unknowns are increasing. So requirement of ground control point also increases. And we have seen that if I require a minimum of 3 ground control points for first order transformation, I take one more for determining the accuracy. Same concept will be holding in the second order also. We require a minimum number of ground control points, we will add one more ground control point. So with this, after we have obtained after we have done the resampling, we get our image, rectified image with its appropriate ground coordinates attached, right? With this, we are removing all kind of errors from my satellite data. The radiometric as well as geometric errors get removed and my image gets associated map coordinates. So this is the first step, which is basically image rectification and registration and radiometric error correction, combinedly called as image pre-processing. I would like to thank you for paying attention and listening to this talk on the basic concepts of image processing, and we had large number of questions. It was very good for me also to interact with you. Thank you.